In 1993, with the release of Mosaic, the world made its decision. Links would be blue. This is the single most important design decision in the history of web design. And not a single record was left about who made it. This makes unraveling the prerequisites and consequences of this decision all the more fascinating. And the consequences of this decision are, I dare say, monumental. This choice didn't just define the development of web design or influence all spheres of design, it largely predetermined how we use electronics today. It was the choice of link color that created the first digital augmentation of our brain's mechanisms, setting a vector that over the past 30 years has turned all of us into informational cyborgs. How did this happen? And why the color blue? You probably already know the popular story. Blue is a biologically pleasing color. The theory goes that evolutionarily, those who were more drawn to the sky and water were more likely to survive. Unfortunately, this is complete nonsense. Color, unlike sound or touch, is processed slowly through the visual cortex by our neocortex. And anything processed there primarily derives its meaning from culture and learning, not from a direct natural response. Color is a bit of information in our most crucial information source. We perceive 83% of all information visually through forms, color, and light, and the individual bits of this information are like letters in a word. If the brain had an emotional attachment to each letter, it would be much harder for us to form them into words. Of course, color psychology exists, but it works as a composite part. The singular appearance of a text color cannot have any noticeable effect based on some evolved biological perception of that specific color. But more importantly, in the 1980s, when the first digital worlds were being built, engineers had no time for poetry. The answer lies not in psychology, but in the rigid constraints of code. Recognize this? I was there using an eyedropper to pick colors from a palette just like this in my first design projects. The choice of colors was severely limited. Not only were there few colors, but there were also strict requirements. First, the color had to be dark enough to be easily readable on a gray background. Second, it had to have enough contrast with black to be easily distinguished from the rest of the text. This didn't leave many options: red, blue, green, cyan, and purple. And quite simply, blue was the best choice on both counts. And right next to it in the palette was that very purple, which almost immediately became the color for visited links. A huge, super important detail we'll return to shortly. So, while we know the technical reason, hindsight is always 20/20. In reality, blue for links became the standard in 1993, because that's how the Mosaic browser rendered them. But who exactly made that decision and how is lost to history? The most logical version, however, is that the creators had seen the research from the mid-1980s. Professor Ben Schneiderman and his team at the University of Maryland's Human-Computer Interaction Lab conducted a series of controlled experiments to find the optimal color for highlighting interactive text based specifically on contrast and readability. Plus, 1983 saw the release of HyperTease, one of the first pieces of software with hypertext markup then used for offline journals, not the online world. And it already had blue links. The creators of HyperTease, in fact, cited the University of Maryland's research. So, although we have a clear reason for the spread of blue links, we don't know for sure whether its roots are in Maryland and HyperTease, or if it was a purely technical decision that just happened to align with scientifically proven best practices. In any case, starting in 1993, a standard for web navigation emerged. Blue, which says you can go here, and purple, which says you've already been here. And as is often the case in human history, it's only after standardization that a brilliant invention becomes a cultural cornerstone for all of society. You've likely seen this image. The illusion is that there is no red in it, but our brain has such a strong association between this brand, this shape, and this color that it fills in the blanks based on past cultural experience, not on the objective wavelength of the color. One manifestation of this function is called the memory color effect. This concept states that our memory of an object's typical color influences how we perceive it. A banana appears more yellow than it actually is because in our memory it's strongly associated with yellow. Over time, the same thing happened with hyperlinks. We don't just see blue text, our brain, recognizing the context, already expects to see blue, associating it with the function of a link. This is a much more evolutionarily understandable effect, which in turn is explained by information foraging theory. This theory suggests that humans search for information in a way that is analogous to how animals forage for food. We navigate by cues or information scent that suggest a particular path will lead to a valuable resource. The blue underlined hyperlink is the most successful and universal information scent ever created in the digital environment. it is consistent. Its standardized appearance means we don't have to learn a new system of signifiers every time. It is reliable. The blue/purple system informs us whether a path has already been explored. It is psychologically optimized. Its color fosters the ideal cognitive state for exploration. The blue/purple system isn't just a clever design choice. It's the first mass market example in human history of outsourcing a brain function to an external interface. It's an external memory. It's cognitive offloading. It's the first real step into cyborgism. Every time you see a purple link, you aren't just seeing a color, you are using a computer as a substitute for your memory. Yes, it's only for storing a very narrow type of information, where I've been and where I haven't, but it is nonetheless true digital augmentation. And what happens when something becomes a standard, a cultural code for a massive number of people, and when it also integrates itself into their cognitive systems? We know the answer from the two browser wars. They erupted because browsers are a unique type of software, separate from everything else, that from the very beginning grew their audience at a rate no one could match until the era of AI. In effect, it was a war between platforms for accessing information. Sound familiar? The speed of development and audience acquisition in browsers was so immense that after the first browser war, we entered an era of stagnation. Internet Explorer, having defeated everyone, seemed horribly outdated, and Microsoft was seen as the villain killing the internet. But after the second browser war and the coronation of Chrome, we realize it's not so black and white. The larger the audience, the higher the cost of any change. When the user base is small and consists of either enthusiasts who are naturally more inclined to experiment, or professionals for whom usability is less critical because they have reasons to use the interface beyond simple want or don't want, it's easy to experiment with interaction models. But once a feature hits the mass market, the potential for change plummets, while the cost of those changes in the form of user churn, negative feedback, and reputational damage skyrockets. This is precisely why every browser war ended in stagnation and why we now live in a world where the fundamental design of browsers hasn't changed in 20 years, just as the core concept of tabs hasn't changed, and problems that have existed for years find no solutions. And that is why the explosive growth we're seeing now, where old technologies serve as a springboard for new ones like AI chats, is fraught with risk. Reaching a massive audience too quickly makes experimentation too expensive. The product doesn't have time to reach its full potential in a safe sandbox. And now another breakthrough is needed to create a new sandbox to continue that evolution. Until then, for better or worse, links will remain blue. And now you know why and what that says about us as a biological species and as a cultural community. Actually, I didn't conduct all this research just for this video. It was part of my work crafting the design philosophy for a new browser, Huli.io. It's precisely this approach, a deep dive into history, philosophy, and culture, that allows for design decisions that are deliberate and consistent, not chaotic. For instance, our analysis of browser history gave birth to the concept of flows as an alternative to tab groups. Without understanding the past, it's impossible to design a deliberate future. So if your company also wants to find its clear path, one based on deep principles, not fleeting trends, you know where to find me. That's why I am convinced that we are now in the midst of a third browser war. It just looks very different because the way we perceive information has changed dramatically with the advent of AI, specifically LLMs, but the fundamental dynamics of interacting with an audience during the war itself are almost identical. And if you want to better understand why this is happening and where it has led us before, watch my video about the browser wars and how they shape design. The most important application on your computer will soon cease to exist. But that's all for here. Bye.